Shopkeeper. Sylph. This pretty young woman stands unnaturally still. Suddenly, her large, glassy eyes spring to life with a rattle and quickly lock with yours, before just as quickly snapping away. Her skin, as fair as porcelain, is cracked beneath several layers of dirt and faded makeup, and on the side of her neck you see what appears to be a small tattoo of vertical lines with glyphs etched at the bottom. For a moment, familiarity overwhelms you, disappearing as a minute shudder runs down her arms. Her gaze snaps back to your face, but not to your eyes. She's staring at your tattoo. Jerkily, her hand rises to touch her own. Well met. I am called Sylph. You note the slight pause before she pronounces her name. Her voice has a purring quality under which you can hear the spinning of countless gears. Oh. Says she's a synthetic cast-off. She coughs just once, and a small greenish cloud emerges from between her lips. How did you come by that mark? She thinks, it's her, or is... Try to remember where you've seen Sylph's tattoo before. I figured it's the same tattoo as mine. You hear an echo of yourself and see in front of you a strange old man, gnarled by time and rabid with expectation. On his neck, weathered and sagging, you see the same series of vertical lines etched into his skin, a faded map to a time or a place that no longer exists. An inadmissible period of time has elapsed without an answer. Conclusion. I will rephrase the question. She says as the memory fades, how did you come to have those marks upon your skin? I'm the changing god, I created this body myself. What's it to you? Ooh, red tide. Aggression noted. She says without any indication of events, a different approach will be initiated. She regards you, head tilting to the side with a series of small ratcheting noises. You have the absurd impression the motion is meant to be flirtatious. I hope you will answer another question for me. I have a riddle that it may please you to answer, she says, brushing her hair coquettishly back from her bare shoulders. It is very old. She pauses a moment, then recites from memory. Why is she trying to flirt with me? What comes in with breath and out with a word transmutes upon death, but can't be conferred? Air? Oxygen? The words sound vaguely familiar, resonating in your mind even after she stops speaking. Old, she thinks. Ha! It's what you've done for centuries. You told me. Try to remember where you've heard the riddle before. The words sound familiar, but something about them is subtly wrong. Just when you think you've grasped the difference, it slips from your mind, and you're left only with Sylph's expectant gaze. Okay, well, at least we have choices. Multiple choice question. In with breath, out with a word. Transmutes upon death, but can't be confirmed. Life? Consciousness? No. Nothing. Maybe love? Love in with a breath? Transmutes upon death but can't be confirmed. I think it would be consciousness. But consciousness doesn't go in with breath and out with a word. Nothing. Blue tide. Query. Is this a pessimistic viewpoint or a positivist one? Positivist one. Is it that nothing can be taught or everything can be taught? She turns her head from side to side as if to shake loose the thought that has gotten stuck in her mind. I must abandon this line of reasoning, she concludes, ceasing her motion. I hope I do not offend. I have one last question to ask of you. You may not have an answer. She looks beyond you, remaining still for some moments while the gears inside her stomach clatter and whir. Then she meets your gaze again and asks her question. I wonder who she was in our past life, how we knew her. What would you do if you met someone who had succeeded at your life's work before you and they refused to share their method? Beg them to tell me. Kill them. Find my own method. Find a new life's work. I would find my own method. Blue Tide. That would doubtless be difficult. The darkness behind her eyes whirls with glints of metal as her pupils dilate fully. They snap back to normal, and she bows slightly. I wish you luck in your endeavor. I have no more questions for you. I'm trying to remember where you've seen her before. Oh, I can't advance. Nope. Failure. For an instant, Sylph as she was is present in your mind's eye, her face painted in brighter, more human colors, as her gaze downcast. She sneaks a glance at your eyes, and the memory fades, replaced by the polite scrutiny of Sylph, who is now. Well, that's out. We're out of intelligence, so I can't boost that thing. Examine Sylph more closely to determine her origin. For lore machinery and lore natural. We can't do what? There you go. Success! You study her cracked porcelain skin, the way her joints are covered by the seams in her clothing, and what once must have been a remarkably pretty face. You recall a fragment of ancient machine history, discovered by your sire in a place called the Wheel of Baz. Automatons like Sylph were created in many different shapes to please their owners. No two alike, all handcrafted and unique. Only a few survivors were known to the machine minds of Baz, and those went for sale to the highest bidder. Huh. So was she my little love machine or something? In my past life? 2XP. It seems likely that Sylph started her life as one of these abandoned constructs, having somehow retained her consciousness despite supposed deactivation. For good or ill, she is now her own person, and, from the sound of her inner workings, one with an expiration date. Who are you? I am Sylph, she states simply, inclining her head toward you with an audible click. I am at your service. Who are you again? I am Sylph. How may I assist you? You can, apparently. Take care. what's on the table? The technology that suspends the tables prevents them from being easily flipped, dragged, or moved. Given the location, this is probably a good thing. Ho, barkeep! Seen you before, haven't I? Locals don't usually drink here. Tarnach Hobbes. The man's brow is creased with worry. He avoids your gaze, his eyes fixed on a point to your left and far away. His trembling, battered fingers pluck at the air. He stares through the chattering customers, the bar, as though he is utterly alone. Stepping closer, you see a thick blue crease running down his throat into the depths of his heavy robes, and orderly rows of azure holes pierce his bony arms from elbow to wrist. Discord, he says as you approach. Scarred melody. Too many voices. Hurts. His words stream out one by one in a subdued and continuous monotone, tumbling over each other as if in a blind rush to escape. Study him. He does not meet your eyes as you step closer to examine him. Instead, he winces, as though your presence is somehow painful to him. You watch him move and track the twitching of his fingertips. You hear a low, vibrating whistle, though it is not coming from his mouth. What are you doing here? Wayfarers bring me broken Numenera. I repair them for pay. I need to eat, he cries. And you don't think you're the target of his anger. The wayfarers thank me, he says, swallowing. They do not know if I have remade their Numenera. They do not know they will also be remade. He thinks all will be remade when the choir awakens. What are you doing here again? Becoming. Repairing Numenera. Remaking them. Repairing the choir. Can you remake any of my Numenera? Instead of asking to see your belongings, he looks at you for the first time. His pupils are as dark as the space between stars. No, he says after a long moment. His eyes flick back to whatever distant, terrible place has so captured his attention. You're wounded, a broken instrument. He has no use for you. You didn't even look at my belongings. Do I have anything you can remake? No, you are worthy, but broken. This time he doesn't look at you. What are you staring at? The grand hall, the spiral pinned by broken columns, the invisible roof. He stops with a gasp, and a tear rolls down his dirty cheek. He tells me not to share our secrets with you. You are not of the choir. You are discord. A cold wind coils down from the rooftop, flicking at his tattered robes. He thinks, must not speak of a car. What if I do this? I want to. A car? What does that mean? He's gonna freak out. You may as well have slapped the man. White with shock, he doubles over, clutching at his chest. Beneath the man's agony, you sense otherworldly indignation and ageless despair, deep as oceans. Great Akar was once the mightiest of cities and will rise once more when the choir awakens. His gaze meets yours. The conductor will reward your curiosity, and allow me to tell you what I have seen. You need only ask. I wish to know what you've seen. Before my becoming, I found a pit ringed with stone deep in the Arvern wood, broken pillars at the edges. I stepped inside, breathed the dusty air. He pauses, passing a shaking hand over his mouth. I was lost in the grand hall for days, decades, pillars twisting like hallways, spiraling, the ringing of bells, whirling chandeliers, listening to the song of the lost choir. I was an audience becoming an instrument. Finally, I slept, and I woke here, upon the heights. He took my voice, the man says, his eyes dull and distant, but my blood sings. I am becoming. I dream, and I remake Numenera for wayfarers so they will become and dream as well, and together we will go into the forest, to the ring where the grand hall once stood, and rebuild. Okay, well, I have many questions. Let's see if I can ask them. He falls silent, eyes wide and wet, as if dreaming of the city that lives in his mind. Also, I think I have to level up. Or did I do that? I'm gonna check it. What do you think you're becoming? An instrument, he says, swaying. A doorway. Before, I remade Numenera. Now I wake and find devices the conductor has made for me. He is generous. Look, he says, smiling, and pulling aside his robes to bare his bony chest. Countless devices are embedded in his flesh, looping bloodlessly in and out of his ribs, linked by tubes or wire to an opalescent sphere at the base of his throat. Damn. You study the blue crease, the subcutaneous cable, leading up from the sphere into his skull. You suddenly recall seeing a similar device in your studies and understand what this one is meant to do. Soon this man will go to sleep, and something will wake in his place, in his body. A doorway, indeed. Really? Like a portal? Tell me what you're becoming again. An instrument, a doorway, he says, smiling proudly. A conductor. Same. You said that you dream. What of? Proud Akar at its peak, he says, gaze locked on the distant ruins of the city, instruments of metal and flesh ringing the balconies of the grand hall, the conductor, our heir, breathing him in forever. Akar and the choir, the man whispers, exhaling, the conductor, our heir, the music, our blood. Okay, farewell. Leave me to the harmony. Will do. Because I have no idea what to do with you. Oh, this goes down to underbelly? Oh, Cliff's Edge. Oh, Cliff's Edge. We haven't been to Cliff's Edge. You know what I'm going to do, though? This stair's there. Right.
All right.
Hey, what's up there? Evidently, we're not done. We can't go that way. Oh, wait. Let's go this way. We can go past the door anyway. Unless that door is like a dimensional thing. Or maybe it goes under this. Under this floor. Gibra Merchant. Gibra Merchants. The dry lands are wearing on me. I must return to Emrajulio soon. Like aquatic based. We had a good trip this time. You air breathers have a taste for our spices, it seems. I can't wait to get home and eat some fried grappa. The Sagus version tastes like minty mud.
We shall see.
Sailor. This is my favorite dock. You can't go 10 steps without getting into a fight. Well, I don't want to do that, necessarily. Why? You're from around here, aren't you? Why is everything so expensive? Hey, honey. I'm only on shore for a few more hours. You busy? Yes, I am. Vargellin child. We were not supposed to land here. Our airship nearly crashed. I thought we were going to die. Vargellin. This was not our destination. We were headed for the oasis of Emrajulios. These plants cling to the top of the wall, their roots hanging in empty air. Their means of obtaining nourishment eludes you. Okay, so that goes there. You know what that is.
Yes.
Let's finish looking around here.
Of course.
Are these ships here? I wonder if we can board them. Laborer. This isn't the best job I've ever had, but you can't beat the view. Yeah, I'd be peeing my pants about that. I can't go there. Examine. Dotted with air holes, several crates aboard this ship rattle and jump, apparently just as eager to disembark as the crew. Cool. Too bad we can't go on it and look around.
Sure enough.
The way he says that is funny. Sailor. Not taken to the air tonight, are you? It's a bad night for it. Driftwood held aloft by suspension platforms provide a useful, if somewhat perilous, bridge between the dock and ships moored in the area. Yeah, I'd say it looks pretty dangerous. So there's more that way. And what's that? I didn't see that. Let's go see what's over there. Looks like that ends.
Without doubt.
Without a doubt it ends. Master Rennio. Hail, Master Rennio. This airship master is keeping a nervous eye on his vessel. He's a short and wiry man, dressed in travel-stained but well-kept clothing. He is chewing on his impeccably groomed mustache in frustration. As you approach, he turns away from his vessel. Welcome to Master Rennio's Aerophile Adventures. I'm afraid that I will not be departing anytime soon, not since the theft. He says the word carefully, as if holding it at bay. I've always taken pains to see the best in people, he confides, swallowing hard, but that was before that runty, glowing, straw-haired robot stole... Sorry, robot? Straw-haired idiot stole the coronet. My prized airship. He shakes his head, genuinely distraught. Until that thief is caught, my ship remains in dock, safely shuttered and chained. Can you tell me how your ship was stolen? So, we... I guess it was another ship of his? Of course, he says, looking grateful that you've taken an interest in his plight. The vagrant asked to borrow my airship first, if you can believe that. I refused, of course, and as politely as possible. He shakes his head slowly, sorrow stealing into his face. I only looked away for a moment to sign some paperwork, and when I turned back, he was already in the air, waving from the railing. I'll help you find him. That would be a great relief, he says, sighing. If you do stumble over him, bring him to me. I want to look the thief in the eyes and ask why he did this to me. Gold tide raised.
Making a note.
In the meantime, what can Master Rennio's aerophile adventures do for you? Can you remind me what the airship thief looked like? He was a shorter fellow with blonde hair and a thin build. He was also glowing. He scowls. I should have known what he was planning. Well, I've seen his type before. Reckless. Thrill seekers. I've never understood them. He nibbles at his thinning mustache. Tell me about yourself. The tiniest smile creases his face. I am the proprietor of this business and a ship's captain. In happier times, I ran a fleet of vessels to various ports of call. He shrugs. These are not happier times, and my fleet has been reduced. Now I have but a single vessel. He shrugs. Such is life. You build for your family, and the vicissitudes of fate drive your plans into the rocks. But my struggling enterprise is the least of the gifts I hope to bequeath to my heirs. I try to teach them dedication, endurance, fairness in all dealings. He shoves his hands into his pockets. What good would it do them to see me take unfair advantage? I would rather be ruined than teach them that falsity is the route to success. My apologies. This has been much on my mind of late. You did not ask about my philosophy. I am Master Rennio, former ship captain and proprietor of Master Rennio's Aerophile Adventures. Thank you most kindly for your interest. Where do you travel? Once I flew as far as Agur Kala, soaring above Arvin Wood and the unmeasured depths of Ornu Lake. Those are the ones that android over it mentioned. Agur Kala and Arvin Wood. Oh, was that the guy with the... No, that was the guy with the music? Oh, we read about it in that book. Or some of those. Above the lava fields of Asafagan and the plains beyond, I flew south over the ruins of the Tabat homelands and east to the oasis of Emragolios. He gestures at his single vessel. Now I fly solely to the Valley of Dead Heroes, conveying mourners and memorialists to the unchanging tombs. Doesn't sound that much like an adventure. He thinks things will turn around one day, I'm sure. In the meantime, we have honest work and food to eat.
Making a note.
Of course I'm not flying anywhere at the moment, not while the thief who stole my other airship walks free. He barks a short, not quite bitter laugh. In these times, only to the Valley of Dead Heroes. The endless battle has seen to that, and my poor vessel has seen better days. What can you tell me about the Caravanserai? Steeped in history, my friend, and you've come to the right man to ask about it. He adjusts his clothes and stands taller. This was once a staging ground against our foes, the Tabat. Our ancestors could observe the approaching enemy from here and direct their forces to meet them. They say that the defense was commanded from up here. He points toward a rocky outcrop on the far side of the plateau. Now, instead of a place of war, it serves as a place of commerce, built for the good of all, both ourselves and our foreign guests. Sega's Cliff sits atop a great hoard of Numenera and does a thriving business in the stuff. We import foods, spices, textiles, and visitors from far-off lands. They arrive from Agur Kala, Astaria, and Hayrest, among many, many others. My friend, this is a focal point of commerce in the Sega's Protectorate. He smiles. I play a small but proud part. Can you tell me more about the Caravanserai? Friend, this is the best place in the city if you're a merchant. You can look out over the Garavia Sound and see the ships roll in. Over there, the bloom. You can watch the ebb and flow of commerce, hear the clinking of shins, and you know that the world is functioning as it should, for the benefit of us all. Alright, we're done. Aye, farewell. Nothing over here to look at? Interesting.
Naturally.
Weird how they have this spot with nothing in there to see. You would think something like this. Yeah, nothing.
With alacrity.
Yeah, what's this thing? I can interact with it as well? Let's save that for last. Let's see what's down here.
Of course.
Laborer. I don't mind carrying stuff around so much. It's the inspections that'll kill you. This craft is capable of carrying one person, two at most. The interior is richly appointed with satin pillows, and the air feels cooler inside. Okay. Quijano del Toboso. Get a good look at him. This scrawny old man practically rattles inside dull and dented armor that was clearly made for someone bigger than him. Nonetheless, his eyes burn with a bottomless fire, and his smile, as fierce as it is genuine, flashes beneath his growing graying thicket of a beard. "Another night," he bellows, clapping your shoulders with his gauntleted hands. You barely keep your feet. The man is stronger than he looks. "Another hero in search of great adventure. You stand before the wandering knight Quijano del Toboso. What brings you to the summit of Mount Theodore?" He thinks she is armed like a knight, though she carries herself strangely. "Why do you call this Mount Theodore? It's a city, not a mountain." "A city," he says, his sweat-beaded brow drawing together. "Your senses must have deserted you in the ascent. The heat has baked you in your armor." He lays a gentle hand on your shoulder, turning you to the horizon. "Do not allow delirium to blind you to your accomplishments, good knight. You have scaled the very heights of Mount... You have scaled the very heights of Mount Theodore, the tooth of the world beast. Adventure lies in every shadow below us. Every sparkle of light is a quest, ready for the taking. What brings you up here?" "Do you know," he says, "that I am not quite sure? My memory is not what it was. I recall kneeling before my family's armor in our estate some time ago." He blinks slowly. "Perhaps I was weeping." He smashes his gauntlet against his chest, leaving a sizable dent. "I can't recall, and it doesn't matter. For then I heard a thunderous roar and beheld a great beast in the skies. I donned my armor and gave chase." What kind of beast was it? "It defied description," he declares, "and so I shall describe it to defy impossibility itself. 13 legs, 6 jaws, 1,000 eyes aglitter with malice and flame. Scales the color of clouds." Alright, go on. "The horrible beast leered down at me, promising destruction. I promised it death, and it fled across the sky. I followed, darting between the trees." He pauses, frowning. "And I don't recall much after that. I remember walking, having various adventures along the way, of course, but I can't quite recall why I came here." "Ah," he says, raising a finger, "of course. I must have had the frankly brilliant notion of scaling this lonely mountain to better spot the beast from afar." He shakes his head, his wispy beard waggling. "Alas, I've seen nothing so far." That was an amazing story. Thank you. "You are most welcome," he says, patting your hand fondly. "It is so good to share my tales with a fellow knight. Everyone else raises such peculiar doubts." "You said you're looking for a great adventure?" "Yes, but I feel I must speak plainly," he says, plucking at his beard. "Too many people have mistaken me for a common mercenary." He straightens. "I am not interested in entangling myself in local quarrels. I will not hunt a beast that cannot hunt me in return. and if I am to fight, it must be against a foe of such wickedness that the stars themselves would wink out rather than shine upon a world that could harbor such malevolent creatures. Actually, I can't think of any enemies worthy of you. Oh, he says, his face falling. Perhaps you will think of one later. I may know of an enemy that is worthy of you. I do. I can only pray that you are right, good knight. Let's talk about something else. Farewell. I will stand vigil here until your return. Okay. Okay, buddy. But perhaps he will come in useful. If we find something worthy of him. So we've explored this entire place, we just haven't looked at this thing. And that goes to back to Government Square. Cliff's Edge. Cave of the Lost Worlds down there. Oh, does that go to there? Alright, let's see what this thing is. Atop a nearby plateau, you can just make out the top of a small dome of scintillating blue energy. Now if we click here, we can interact. No. Alright, well that's it then. I can't click on the... Wait. I go like that. I'm not telling that guy about the thing we found yet. Oh, let's take a look at her stuff, by the way. The Airship Thief. Master Rennio, an airship captain at the Caravanserai, is looking for the man who stole one of his vessels. Until the thief is caught, he has grounded his remaining ship. Find the man who stole the airship. The thief was below average height and had straw-colored hair. He was also glowing. Okay, and what we found here... Antique hair clip. Do we even look at this? Oh, we didn't even look at this. This metallic, flower-like device consists of a short metal stalk with a mechanical eye at the end. It was given to you by Salamary and can apparently be used as a key to enter the Anechoic Lazarae, a large golden structure in the Reef of Fallen Worlds. And... Badge of Officer, I found that. Antique hair clip. This small ornamental comb is actually a living jeweled insect, a biomechanical marvel. The pinchers seek to fasten themselves upon locks of hair, and its wings allow it to hover around the wearer's head, creating unique styles that would otherwise be impossible. Now... Oh, do I have to... No, I already leveled up. Okay. Dominant Tide is back to just simply blue again. That's cool. It was like sharing silver for a while. It would be cool if we could see, you know, the breakdown of how much percentage silver, blue, gold I have. But no. Maybe when the game's over. At least not that I know of. Right. Return to him with the evidence. Now I wonder if we could find him... Find her instead. So I'm going to hold off on that. Anyway, thanks so much guys for watching. Next time we're going to return to Circus Minor and talk to the people there and see if we can stop this. Oh, you know what? Yeah, I'm not going to rest. Hold on one second. 3 points of intellect. I'm afraid that if I sleep, he'll be executed. Because he told me that he was going to be he's currently being executed, and we only have so much time. 3 points of might. So my might is fine, I just need maybe a little speed and intellect. Let's use it. That Did that work? Oh, on myself? I have to click? Cool. Just so I can use my points and then I'll sleep. And in case we need speed... Intellect... Health... Might... You know, I don't have anything for speed. That would have to be enough. So that'll be next episode. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.